Same old, same old. All Saints Sunday. No matter who you are or where you are welcome here. You're welcome here whether you are here physically or you are watching this later on the internet. We're glad that you're with us. Please take a moment and sign the friendship register, which is in your bulletin or in your pew. A note about our Thanksgiving food drive. You still have time to bring your food back. And we have some bags piling up out there. It's wonderful, and we thank you so much for that generosity on the part of the congregation. If you have questions, you're welcome to call the church office about that. Thanks for everybody who contributed candy so that we are helping the dental profession here in Woodstock, and hopefully also selling a lot of toothpaste and toothbrushes for the little ones. And how wonderful that we have no rain today for tonight when kids come trick-or-treating. Please attend to your bulletin for any other announcements. And in particular, I always like to draw your attention to the names of people in the insert who need prayers and or cards. They and we all depend on each other's prayers. And so please take that home with you and remember to pray for these saints of ours throughout this week. And now I ask that you would stand in body and or spirit for our call to worship. Please stand. In all our weakness and strength, with our youth-filled spirits and aging bodies.
We come to be dear people of God.
Strong in faith and eager with questions, singing our praise and whispering our prayers.
We come to be dear people of God.
Filled with saintly determination, yet mindful of our human limitations.
We come to be your people, O God.
Made strong in your endless love for us, we know ourselves to be yours.
We come to be your people, O God. May we truly become your people today. Amen.
Please remain standing as we sing hymn number 507, A Mighty Fortress, hymn number 507. Turn our hope to Christ, our Savior. Our lives are full of mistakes and errors, places where we have followed self-generated idols rather than the one true God. And we are not alone in all of these mistakes. All of those who have come before us were also plagued with temptation and sin. So let us come before God as generations of believers have done, and pray for God's forgiveness and grace. Let us pray together the prayer of confession. Beloved God, who was known to our mothers and fathers, and even to our spiritual forebears, have mercy on us. We do not always love as you would have us. We do not always do as you would have us do. In our stubbornness, we turn from you when we should turn toward you. Hold us, dear one. Comfort us when we mourn the passing of friends and family. And help us to know that they are rejoicing in your presence. We praise you for the grace you shower on us, constantly forgiving our errors, especially the ones that we don't share with any but you. Hear now the silent fears and worries of our hearts. Friends, hear the good news. Though thousands upon thousands of our ancestors did not follow God's way perfectly, we have hope in the one who did, Jesus, a man of a particular people in a particular time, taught us through his words and deeds that God has already forgiven us. Thus we and all who have come before us are rightly known as saints, the holy ones of God. Thanks be to God for God's mercy, grace, and love. Amen.
Thank you.
remember all those whose labors are now ended. We remember those from St. Paul's United Church of Christ who entered into eternal rest this past year.
Perform remembrance these words. I'm no longer by your side. There's no need to weep. I've left sweet recollections I'm hoping you will keep. Eternal joys and memories stay in our hearts forever, strengthening our special bond that parting cannot sever. Now it's time to journey on, so let your faith be strong, for I am in a better place. I'm home where I belong. And if times of loneliness bring sorrow and dismay, don't despair, for I am there, just a memory away. Those we remember today. Louise Song McInturf, November 23rd, 2020. Louise was married to the late Ephraim McInturf. She survived by two daughters, Patricia Dellinger and Linda Eppert, two sisters, and six grandchildren, including Ricky Dellinger and his wife Patty, members of St. Paul's. Jane Ellen Finley McEwen, December 2nd, 2020. Jane is survived by her children, James, Scott, and Michelle, and two sisters, including St. Paul's pastor Anne Finley Chamberlain. James Richard Dick Seibert and wife Barbara Ann Seibert, February 9th and 10th. Dick was the son of James and Geraldine Seibert. He survived by six brothers, Tom, St. Paul's members Joe and Bill, Gary, Gerald, Steeter, and Mike. Barbara is survived by a brother. Dick and Barbara are also survived by their son, Eric. Marcella Marcy McKinney Lambert, April 4th. Marcy was a member of St. Paul's. She survived by her husband of 63 years, Richard Lambert, and two children, Pamela Gray and Ricky Lambert, four grandchildren, and two great-grandchildren. She is also survived by a brother and four sisters. Regina Rose Rao Miller, April 26th. Regina was a member of Mount Calvary UCC. She is survived by Weldon, her husband of 62 years, also three brothers, and many nieces and nephews, including St. Paul's members Derek and his wife Julie Rittenhauer. Anna Mae Lambert, June 4th. Anna is survived by her husband, Terry Lambert, previous member of St. Paul's, their son Chris, and daughters Teresa and Dee, two sisters, five grandchildren, and his husband, Terry, is a cousin of St. Paul's member, Patty Dellinger. Craig W. Rich, July 21st. Craig is survived by his wife, Janet, daughter of St. Paul's member, Jennifer Dalton, and a son, Jared, also survived by a sister and brother. Calvin William Butch Hassel, August 8th. Butch is survived by daughters Sharon and Michelle, sister Peggy, brother Ralph, four grandchildren and five great-grandchildren. Butch is the uncle of St. Paul's member Janice Seibert. Larry Wilson Lamb, October 13th. Larry is survived by his wife, Jane, son, Mike, daughter, Melanie, brother, Terry, and two grandchildren. Larry is a cousin of St. Paul's member, Patty Dell.
Please join together for the congregational response. For all that they were by nature and faith, and to those who love them, we give you thanks, O God. We remember all those close to our hearts who have entered eternal rest this year. For all that they were by nature and faith, and to those who love them, we give you thanks, O God. And let us pray together. Merciful and loving God, We are renewed by the courage of the saints who have gone before us. We are inspired by the saints who walk among us today. Thanks be to God for this great cloud of witnesses. Amen.
Place for you to dwell in forever.
thank you for the senior choir. It will be good when we can sing together again, and we're getting closer to that day. Well, it was a warm spring day in 2016, and Andrea and I were having a farewell outdoor lunch at a restaurant that fronted one of Honolulu's harbors. We were both moving from Hawaii back to the mainland and had served for years as pastors in Hawaii. And we were reminiscing about our time and our friendship in Hawaii. As we looked out over the blue ocean waters of the Pacific, we could see fully loaded cargo ships heading towards California. If it had been right now, our stuff would still be on that cargo ship. We might well never get back to our house, but fortunately it was in 2016. Andrea made a note, she said, you know, all those containers are holding, they're holding the containers that contain people's personal goods. Our containers that contain everything that we own could be on one of those ships. They could be passing in front of our eyes. And then she wondered out loud, I wonder what it would feel like if your container sank. It's a great question, and the kind of question that only a great friend would think of to ask, and those often go together. I did some quick calculations in my mind of what would be lost if our container sunk to the bottom. None of our household items are really valuable at all, except for the personal value of the things that we have that couldn't possibly be replaced. Like my great-great-great-grandmother's quilt that we have a portion of that was made in 1835. Or my great-grandmother's platform rocker that has been put together and restuffed several times to help it survive that was a gift to her mother in 1885. Or the hutch that Rod's great-grandfather built for his great-grandmother as a wedding gift. Or perhaps our photo albums. All those things mean something to us, but they couldn't possibly ever be replaced. And I'm not sure that anyone else except perhaps our children would want any of them. And we certainly won't be able to take any of that stuff with us when we die. John Ruskin wrote, "The best things in life aren't things," and he was right. There's a Senegalese proverb that goes like this: When an elder dies, a library has burnt. You just heard one of my stories about sitting and watching the containers on their way to California, and that's just a tiny sliver of all the stories in my library. The Bible is full of such stories as well. And this morning, we're going to look at a very brief slice, a small slice, of King Solomon's life and some implications that it might hold for us. Solomon's family was incredibly dysfunctional. There was incest, brother killing brother, coups, favoritism, and parents who didn't model or set limits. His father, King David, had 8 wives and 18 children. And David's relationship with Solomon's mother, Bathsheba, began at best by what could be described as an abuse of his power in impregnating her, the wife of another man, whom he subsequently had murdered. That child died shortly after birth, and then along came Solomon. Of all of David's sons, Solomon was the last in line and the least likely to become king, but he was David's first choice. Maybe that's because David was the younger and he was chosen first by Samuel. We don't know. What we do know is that it didn't set for a very good transfer of power. Rough starts don't determine the rest of our lives. Thank heavens. God came to Solomon in a dream and he asked him what he wanted And Solomon chose wisdom. And the books of Proverbs and the Song of Songs, or the Song of Solomon in our Bible, are credited to him and his wisdom. And wise he was. And because he chose wisdom, the Bible tells us that God was pleased with that choice and also gave him great wealth and health. Solomon controlled most of the major trade routes that came out of Edom, Arabia, India, Africa, and Judea. He constructed an elaborate and profitable web of alliances that he assembled together through hundreds of marriages to wives and concubines. And Solomon fulfilled David's dream to build a temple for the Lord. And it must have been an amazing sight to see. It was set atop Mount Moriah. And Mount Moriah is the place where scholars believe Abraham went when he was asked to sacrifice his son Isaac, which God called off at the last moment. The footprint of the temple was 100 feet in length and 30 feet wide, with a ceiling that it places soared to about 45 feet. How would you like to change those ceiling lights? Tom? Thankfully, they didn't have electricity. Its innermost sanctuary, that was called the Holy of Holies, housed the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord, which held the two stone tablets on which God wrote with God's own finger the Ten Commandments. And the gold that adorned the temple at today's rates would have been over $194 billion in gold and $22 billion in silver. $1 billion, by the way, or $100 billion, you can put 12 zeros after that figure. That's how many dollars are in a billion. I can't keep track of money that large, and I'm glad I'm not responsible for the national debt. 7 years after the work began, the temple was dedicated, and there was music, there were prayers, and there were amazing sacrifices. At another place in the Bible, we're told that 22,000 oxen and 120,000 sheep were sacrificed by Solomon alone, as well as all the people's offerings, which might have totaled 250,000 animals. Talk about a smelly blood bath. When the priest finally came out of the holy place, a cloud filled the house of the Lord, and the priests couldn't stand to minister before the cloud. They were terrified. And because the glory of the Lord filled the house of the Lord. Can you imagine? We were talking about this in Cola class, about what it would be like to have a cloud. You know what it's like when the fog descends and you can't even see? Can you imagine being in a place with that many dead animals and that many people and all those prayers and priests, and suddenly a cloud descending which you could not see through? God's glory filled the house of the Lord. God's glory overfilled, because God cannot be contained. Solomon's prayers were some of the finest in Scripture. He acknowledged later in this chapter that heaven, even the highest heaven, could not contain God, much less the house that he had built for God. He prayed that when people turned towards the temple, they would remember the covenant with God, and that God would hear and answer their prayers. Prayers for forgiveness of sin, prayers for rain in times of drought. And he even prayed that foreigners who come and pray to God there would be heard by God and granted their answers. He made something of himself in spite of all of his challenging roots. You see, rough starts don't determine the rest of our lives. I'm a fairly intelligent person, and some people have thought of me as wise, but I have to tell you that I've done some pretty unwise things. Like the time that I was a lifeguard during the summer and was responsible for keeping the family's VW Beetle clean. Now, when you work as a lifeguard at a swimming pool, Rod's already cracking up at this story. You know, you get used to using a hose. You wash down the decks, you wash out the bathhouse with hoses. Well, this Beetle, you know, it had kind of rubber on the floor. So it was up on our driveway, you know, parked going in with the engine at the back, which I didn't calculate. But I figured I could wash out the interior of that car really well with a garden hose. So hosed it down, I did. It looked immaculate inside until my mom backed out of the driveway and then began to drive downhill. And all of the fluids from the battery and battery acid and all that stuff just flowed right on up under the gas pedal. My dad had a phrase for that. And I'm glad there aren't any children here today, because he said a bad word that we're not allowed to say in front of our grandchildren. This is what it was. He said this: how could someone so smart do something so stupid? How could somebody do something like that? Well, I can tell you, I'm living proof. You know, we might assume that everything ended well for Solomon, but success and smarts and wealth and status don't determine how we finish. What does is loving God with all our heart and soul and mind and strength, and loving our neighbors.